Time again for Talking Dogs with Ian Grand, owner of Vermont Dog Boarding and Behavior, VFW Drive Hyde Park. It's the show that delves into the training, socializing, behavior, nutrition, and wellness of your dog. And brought to you by Guy's Farm and Yard with locations in Morrisville, Montpelier, Williston, and St. Albans. And we're back with the trainer, Ian Grand. And here is the question this morning, and it is, what is the difference between a bite and a nip? You know, we always talk about it, you know, nip, things like, just barely touched him in a bite.
Yeah.
So, is there a noticeable difference?
Yeah, I think so. We have to first look at kind of what this is. And a nip can be, communicated differently from the dog, meaning you can get the dog that's very skittish, nervous. You reach out to touch the dog and they just kind of nip your hand just enough to say, hey, buddy, I need a little bit more space. This can also happen with a very playful and excited dog that may jump all over you and you're trying to get them off of you and then you feel teeth on your hand. So that's a little different. This is a little bit more on the exciting part of things. So for this conversation, we're just going to stick with kind of that nervous or skittish dog or the one that's trying to communicate like, I need more space.
Right.
Yeah. So in that aspect, a nip is a bite. I can't tell you how many times I hear this from clients and going, oh, she only nipped me. It's okay. And I'm like, no, it is not okay for the dog to communicate and put their mouth on you. That is the start of something that could go down a road that you don't want to go down and it turn into something that could be more aggressive.
So you don't want to treat it as a minor thing because you considered a quote unquote nip.
Yeah. And also too, when that happens, your first reaction as the person getting nipped is to yank your hand back, right? You don't expect it. All of a sudden there's the pain and you pull your hand back and all of a sudden you're like, whoa, what was that? And of course the dog sees that and now there's just this, all this communication going on. The dog's not sure. You're not sure. You felt pain. Dog's just trying to communicate something to us. So, you know, if said person keeps reaching out to try to pet this dog, it will turn into an actual like bite. You're going to feel the full mouth on your hand.
So that's the difference between a nip and a bite. So a nip is just kind of a slight warning, and the bite has the full force, and they put a lot of thought into it.
Yeah, and if we look at it, dogs don't want conflict, right? Otherwise, everything would be right straight to a bite. They wouldn't care. But the nip is down on the intensity level, and they're saying, hey, I don't want to have to do this, but you're making me do this. And it's a behavior that you don't want your dog to start practicing because then they're going to get better at it. And then they start doing it to other people. And then it becomes kind of their go-to move when they either want space or they want to communicate something. And then the deeper the pattern gets, the longer it takes to break and to, you know, start something new all over again.
So it's not something you want to ignore. Oh, it was just a little nip. So, you know, it didn't really hurt. Because as you said, I mean, this can accelerate to something else. How would it accelerate?
By the human ignoring it. It's no big thing. He just nipped me. It's all right. I'll reach down and try to pet him again. I understand he's upset. Bang, he gets nipped again. Well, I mean, how many times do you have to do this? The unfortunate part is from the dog's eyes, you know, John Doe tried it once. Joe Smith tried it once. Jack Thompson tried it another. So all these people are trying to reach down and pet this dog. And the dog's communicating to each one of these people. They don't like this. But each person doesn't know that the people around them and the other people had tried to reach down and pet this dog too. So then it becomes this cumulative thing that the dog is just forced to react this way. And when the nips don't work, they got to kick it up a notch and then it turns into the bites.
Yeah. Now, if this person is a dog owner, they should know right off the top once it's gone from the first time, well, I'm not doing it anymore. But of course, if you're not a dog owner, you think maybe you did something wrong. Well, I'll try it again. So the first thing is that if you are nipped and you don't go back doing it. Now, what about the dog owner? What do they do about it from being the dog owner's point of view?
It's 1-800-GET-A-TRAINER because it's just too serious at that time. And that's the unfortunate part. People don't think a nip is serious enough for training. So then the nip eventually turns into a bite. Now we need training. So if we look at it and go, okay, this is going to be easier to solve now when it's not a bite and we can adjust things and get it going from there. But when it turns into a bite, it's going to take a little bit longer and it's probably going to take more money too, honestly.
So you can't take it as just a spontaneous, oh, it probably won't happen again, because once it's happened once, then you get a history started then.
Yeah, if it happens once, I kind of look at the context and go, okay, all right, that's why. Okay, if it happens again, all right, now we have a problem. So I would look at it and go, probably twice. Okay, now we need help.
Especially if it happens a second time for a different reason.
Absolutely. Yeah. Absolutely.
Then you know that, okay, we got to nip this at the... I'm sorry.
You couldn't resist.
You knew I was going to get to that finally when we get to the end of this. All right. Back with our question from the doggy bag in just a moment here on Talking Dogs. Back with Talking Dogs with Ian Grant from Vermont Dog Boarding and Behavior, VFW Drive, Hyde Park. Go to his website, VermontDogBoardingAndBehavior.com, to find out more about his programs, his schedule, and boarding, and podcasts, and all of the above. You can find it all right there in one simple location. All right, our question this morning, Ian, is what's the best way to help a dog that is shaking from being nervous? We don't want to pet them then because we don't want to get the nip starting again.
Right. So I threw this is a question for me I threw in here because this past week I had a lesson. Lady came in with her dog. I had never seen a dog tremble so bad in front of me from being so scared, being around. I was the new person in this dog's life. The dog, and this is the dog's reaction around new people. So, you know, this isn't a question I can answer in, you know, 60 seconds here. I sat down with this person for 90 minutes so we could really talk about things. I would agree with what you had said. Petting is not going to be my first move. The other part of it, too, is a dog that's shaking that bad. You're not going to be able to give them food to start training either. To me, a dog that's shaking, that was shaking that bad, I was talking with a client for a little while. But then we have to get that dog up and get it moving and get the brain doing something other than focusing on being in this environment that's so scary. So for me, and what we did was just focus on giving this dog something to do, which in our situation was just walking on leash in our training room. Let's just start simple because you can't get complicated. It's like teaching algebra to a second grader, right? They're not ready for it yet. You have to go back to fundamentals and leash handling and communicating that way. And eventually, I mean, by the end of the lesson, this dog was laid out on her side and she was asleep. But, you know, for those people listening at home, when they have a dog that's that scared or nervous, give them something to do. Even if you have to put them on leash in the house and walk them around, give them something different to think about. It'll help them.
Probably not socializing with other animals would be a good idea. Would that be too much?
At that time, I don't know if I would. If it's like a friend's dog or something like that they were very friendly with and the relationship was already there, then I would certainly try it. Bring another dog over, see if it brings that back out of them. If it doesn't, you can't keep trying. Yeah. And that's one thing about dogs. They just, once you keep trying and it doesn't work, you can't go with it.
Yeah. And you don't want to add to the stress of the dog already by adding another factor, because then you're another one or two steps back.
Yeah. It's like adding layers to it, right? Yeah. You don't want to get too complicated.
If you have a question for Ian, you can email him directly to info@VermontDogBoardingAndBehavior.com. Well, next week, your dog and redirection from stimulation. Boy, that sounds pretty scientific.
Well, sometimes redirection can be aggression, because dogs get so wound up that they can't get to what they're looking at. So they will redirect on somebody else, something else, other objects. So we'll discuss that and what it looks like and how to handle it.
So you do not want the redirection?
No, not in this context.
No. On Talking Dogs with Ian Grant, brought to you by Guy's Farm and Yard, with locations in Morrisville, Montpelier, Williston, and St. Albans. And for the trainer Ian Grant, I'm Roland DeJoy, and we are Talking Dogs.